sing some more of that in just a minute. He's going to sing some more of that in just a minute. But I feel the Spirit of the Lord wooing people's hearts. Calling them. Maybe you're here this morning and you're on the down and out. Maybe you're here this morning and you ain't had a very, very good day, a week, a month, or a year. And you just maybe said some. How many know we can say something to offend God sometimes? And we feel the grievance of God's Spirit within us. And we said, oh, I'm going to go to the altar at the end of the service. But oh, but I want to go right now. Well, I want to say, come on right now.
Thank you.
Somebody say the blood of Jesus. Somebody say that. his spine. He's needing surgery, but he's needing a miracle. Can we pray right now in the name of Jesus for healing? God, for healing. God, this whatever it is that's wrapped around his spine, Father, this mass, Lord. God, we pray right now, Lord, that your hand would go in the midst, oh God. Lord, that you would deliver him, Lord God, from this infirmity, Father. God, in the name of Jesus, we believe you right now, Lord. We believe you right now. Go into that home. Arrest, oh God, arrest that cancer. Whatever this thing, this mass is, arrest it. Take it away, Lord. Father, we love you. We thank you. Don't you feel the Spirit of the Lord in here this morning? The next time you come in here and you feel alone, you got your head down, and everything's bound and nobody wants to worship God, God's going to look to you now to say, lift your head and lift your hands and praise God. And begin to bind that old religious spirit that'll try to hold you captive. Glory to God. Come on, one more time. Give Jesus a good hand type of praise. Isn't the Lord good? See, back a long, long time ago, there was an enemy fighting the camp of God. Pastor Moses took his staff and he drew a line in the sand. He said, everybody on God's side, you got to come across the line. Well, there's been at Calvary, my God, there was another line drawn in the sand. But it wasn't with a stick. No thought. We minister this thought. But there's three of the four gospels gives an account in the book of Mark chapter 6. Three of the gospels give an account about when Jesus sent them into the ship to cross the sea, and he went into the mountain and prayed. But Mark and John kind of gets pushed to the back burner because only Matthew records Peter walking on the water. So we, but God led me back to the book of Mark chapter 6. And I'm saying, how can this be that, now we understand Matthew and John walked with Jesus. Mark and Luke was actually with Paul 40 years later. But I felt the Lord just put in my heart, he said, if every one of the four gospels said exactly the same thing, it never contradicts itself. But if it says verbatim, word for word, why would there need to be four gospels and not just one? The gospels according to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So every one of these, and I've shared this with you, every one of these writers here, they saw things from a different perspective. It never you never in your wildest dreams are going to find a place that the Bible contradicts itself. You're contradicting the Word of God to believe that. Come on, somebody. There's a lot of places we've come across that said, man, this just don't make sense. I mean, just over here it says something almost, but it never contradicts itself. It's just showing you something from a different perspective. Now Jesus and his disciples just fed 5,000 men plus women and children with about 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. I don't know how big the fish is, but I do know how big the loaves used to be when they baked them. They just got through with that, and Jesus now said, listen, I'm going to send the crowd away, but I want you to get in a ship now, and I want you to go to the other side, the Sea of Galilee, Lake Genesaret. It's about 3 names for the Sea of Galilee. And we find in verse 45, again, they fed the multitude. They picked up 12 baskets of fragments. And The Lord don't want nothing to go to waste, friend. No matter how small you think you are in God, God loves you. And He don't want you to go to waste. He cares for you. Glory to God. Mark chapter 6, verse 45. And straightway Jesus constrained His disciples to get into the ship and to go to the other side before unto Bethesda, while He sent away the people. And when Jesus had sent them away, He departed into a mountain to pray. And when evening was come, evening simply means it's the close of the day now. Some translators say it was right at dark. Some say it was on into dark. But when evening was come, the ship was now in the midst of the sea, and Jesus alone on the land. And Jesus saw them toiling and rowing, for the wind was contrary unto them. And about the fourth watch, or about 3 a.m. in the morning, and about the fourth watch of the night, He cometh unto them, walking upon the sea, and would have passed them by. But when they saw Him walking upon the sea, they supposed it had been a spirit and cried out. And they all saw Him and were troubled. And immediately He talked with them and said unto them, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." And He went up into them into the ship, and the wind ceased, and they were sore amazed within themselves beyond measure, and wondered, for they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. Father, we give You praise. We thank You for Your move of this Spirit. The holiness of God moving in our midst today. And Father, I pray now even that through this preaching, the simplicity of these words, Father, to become so profound in the hearts and the minds of Your people, yes, that we can say truly it's been good to be in the house of the Lord. Yes. We give You praise for everything, because You're not only the God of this little building, You're the God of this whole. You've got people that calls You Lord, and You call them children all over this world. We thank You now. We give You glory and praise, and we ask this in Jesus' name. We say amen.
Amen.
Now, our Bibles were saying He a lot, but I don't want you getting confused. Jesus told those disciples to get in the ship now and go to the other side. The Lord blessed the people and sent them away. How many knows God never sent them away hungry? He always fed them. And He was praying. The ship now is out in the sea. They're rowing. They're going somewhere. They had a command from God to go to the other side. So they just simply headed towards Bethesda. But in the midst of that, a storm rises. Jesus is not in the boat this time. He's not asleep on the pillow. They can't just turn around and wake Him up and even accuse Him of not caring. There's a storm. So they just keep rowing. They know they quit rowing, it's going to push them right back, because there's a headwind. And it's just going to simply push them right back to where they started. Meaning they're not going to gain no ground, even when the ground is wet, called water.
Yes, sir.
They got to keep rowing. But they use a word. He saw them toiling in rowing. The word toiling, I believe Mark had this thought in his mind when he was writing the accounts of this trip. He used the word toiling. And the word toiling here simply means to to torture. To torture. It means, in parentheses, pain. They're rowing. And the wind's blowing. And the waves are rising. And it seems like every stroke they make on that oar, they're going in the opposite direction on the commission word to go that way. But they feel like they're going this way. And in all the pain, that the pain gets so profound that it becomes a form of torture. You know how it is. In the midnight hour, when you're in your prayer closet, or you petitioning God, you believe in the Lord, but all of a sudden, the more you pray, the lonelier you feel, and you get up from your prayer sometimes with no satisfaction at all that God has heard your prayer. But there's something. There's a key element in our times of loneliness, in our times of doubt and fear, that if we'll have faith as a grain of mustard seed, we continue to keep rowing. We can continue to keep desiring to move in the direction that God has called us to go.
Yes.
The wind's contrary. If you'll allow me just a few minutes, I want to preach a thought on simply the perils of the midnight voyage. The perils of the midnight voyage. They started in the evening, around when the sun went down. Jesus walks by the boat in the fourth watch. That starts about 3 a.m. So there's a midnight right in the middle of that. And how many knows that every person, every child of God's going to have a midnight experience in their life? The midnight's when it seems like nobody's around. The midnight is a kind of a halfway point where this thing can go for us or against us. The midnight seems to become very lonely at times. There's things that are very profound that happen at midnight in that Bible. But I want to tell you, when the guys that followed the Lord was instructed to get in the boat and to go to the other side, how many knows the Lord himself knew that there was going to be a storm? We shouldn't be feared for that. We should thank the Lord that he knows. The word contrary, the wind was contrary. The wind was in front of them. It was opposing them. It was moving opposite from the direction that they desired to go. But Jesus constrained his disciples to necessitate or to be need. He said, it's needful. Get in this ship and go to that other side. You see, sometimes, friends, our duty at times will oppose our preferences. Our duty, that's a duty now. God's called you to go to that other side. But our duty now will oppose our preferences, especially when you've got a headwind blowing against you. Come on now. When you got a headwind, when you got something fighting you, trying to hinder you, trying to stop you, trying to discourage you from exceeding and excelling in the precious promise of the word that he's already spoke to you. If God's already said it, you can go ahead and call it done. If you're willing to go to the battlefield, if you're willing to stand your ground, if you're willing to believe the word of the Lord, understand, friend, we've been created out of dirt. But can I tell you, when God blew his breath, his holy breath in you and I, the dirt stood up. And now the good things of God is in the creation of Almighty God. That's why Paul said we can do all things through Christ, which strengthens you and I. Because it's not so much about who we are and what we can do, but it's all about who he is and what he's already done. He's a great God. He's a great God. Jesus is a praying in the mountain. And he sees them toiling and rowing, for the wind was contrary. I want to just oppose a few little thoughts this morning. Why would Jesus send them across without giving them the assurance of the night without problems? He left out the most important part. They didn't have no issue of getting in the boat and going to the other side. In fact, they had enough faith intact that we don't find out in any of the Gospels that records the story that they turned and said, well, Lord, how are you going to get over there? There was a somewhat of a faith intact here because they obeyed. Faith is simply obeying what God's told you. That's faith. Everybody calls faith and defines faith with all these supernatural things and all these cosmos things and all that. It's simply reading the Bible and believing what it says. And if God speaks to you to get up and move, you get up and move. That's your faith right there, friend. Amen. And sometimes our faith has got to be put on trial.
Amen.
So why would Jesus send him across without giving them the assurance of a night without problems? He sees them now being tortured by the resistance of something in their mind they think they got no control over. Mark, don't put a silver lining on this. In the middle of the storm, Jesus is walking by. Mark says that he would have passed them by, but they saw him. They were so focused. Listen, God just put this in my heart. I just wrote this down. They were focused so much on contending with the wind that they failed to recognize the one that controlled the wind.
Yes.
Because when they saw him, they cried out with fear, thinking he was a spirit. Now understand, I've never seen a storm without some clouds. And when the wind's blowing and the seas is rising, it's about the 3 o'clock in the morning, and it's dark. And I want to tell you, Jesus ain't a half a mile across the sea. He's walking close enough for them to realize that something's out there, but far enough about that it's going to take faith to recognize who it is. But they thought him being a spirit, amen. And they cried out with fear. But when they cried out, when the Bible, and I love what it says in Mark here, and they all saw him. Man, this morning I think all of us was a praying. All of us was a loving Jesus. There wasn't no binding spirit, amen, to try to oppose the move and the power of God. That's called unity, my friend. We might not all hopped on one foot or all shouted, but we were all had a mindset and a heart to see what God, my God, somebody. I want to tell you, if we'll get unified in Christ, we'll become unified with each other.
Amen.
Man, listen now. So let me stop and throw an anchor. And it's going to take a big anchor because you see, the harder the wind blows and the higher the storm rises, the bigger the anchor you need.
Amen.
But I like that anchor we can cast because his name is the anchor of our soul.
Amen.
Jesus. He sees them toiling. The pain that must have been in the tops of their shoulders and in their back. The muscles that must have been on fire. Because nowhere in the Gospels did they say they throw their oars down and just return from where they come from. No, sir. It's men. There was men that desired to fulfill the command of the Lord. So they just burn and it becomes a torture. You know how it is. When you're laboring and you don't see the fruits of your labor, and you feel like nobody even wants to hear what you got to say about the Lord, and you bombarded with all the condemnation that just creeps into our mind, it seems like you fail one time, but the devil never going to let you forget that, and everybody around you will point out your failure instead of recognizing your faith. Come on, that when you repent of, let me tell you, we fail, we all come short, sin comes short of the glory of God. When we recognize this and we go down to an altar in prayer and ask God in repentance and by faith, the Lord, forgive me of my faithfulness, forgive me of my lack of communicate, forgive me for my lack of commitment, whatever it might be, that's a time that you got to fill in the blanks. How many knows when you touch, oh my God, I said when you touch heaven, heaven's going to say you forgiven now. But you know who the hardest person is to forgive? It's yourself, because you failed, you come short of the glory of God. It seems like the devil just taxing your mind and your body. Some of you here this morning that's sitting, you're sick in your body. You feel horrible. You feel miserable. You don't understand why God, the loving God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, would let you suffer so much. But can I tell you, he's a gracious God. He's a God, amen, that he, oh friend, at times life, that's right, it's not fair. But can I tell you one thing, that he's still on the throne this morning, and you'll just keep laboring. If you'll just keep praying, God's going to bring you to where He wants you to be. Torture. Man, when I saw that, I'm like, oh my. I've been there. Anybody?
Yeah.
Been there? It could be the death of a loved one. And it seems like your pain is so great that it becomes a torture.
Yes.
Maybe you just fell. Maybe you lost your way. And you sinned. You done something that you knew better, but it happened. It becomes torture. Can people love God and sin? Absolutely. Should people that love God sin? No. But that Bible's full of people just like you and I, guys, that love the Lord, but yet they fail. Peter and Judas, basically the same person for what they'd done. But Peter repented. Judas hung himself. But what did Peter not do that Judas did? He betrayed the Lord. Did he not? Did he? The same man, that's the only man outside of Jesus walked on the water, is the same one that denied Him three times. And he said, I don't even know Him. And then he cursed. Huh? But in all of his broken sorrowness, he wept before the Lord. And he becomes such a great, great anointed vessel of God. You know why? Because he didn't quit rowing. He didn't quit coming. He didn't quit praying. He didn't quit acknowledging that God's everything. He didn't throw the oars down. I want to tell you, our past seems like it wants to torture us in the present, to annihilate our future. But you've got to get past the past. We've all had one. And most of us probably ain't too proud of it. But it's a time to just keep rowing. Because can I tell you, Jesus sees you in the middle of your storm. And He's not going to let you try to fight it alone. He's going to come to you. But it ain't going to be in our time. It's going to be in His time. And when He comes, we still won't recognize Him, because is on the tormentor or the torture of the tormentor more than of the man that can destroy the tormentor, because he was destroyed on that glorious cross. Amen. On a hill called Golgotha, Jesus proclaimed victory for the people. And He said, let me just go ahead and seal the deal. And before He ascended on high, He descended down. Amen. And He took the keys of hell and the grave. Come on, somebody. And he led captivity captive, meaning everybody. When He walked into that place, what a religion calls purgatory now, it's no such place now. That was a place of holding for everybody. That was a heathen, or everybody that knew the Lord, Jehovah. But in the midst of all that, when Jesus made His interest into that place of holding, He said, I am the great I am. Abraham said, you're Him. You're the one that I would. Moses said, I saw you. When I was hid in the cleft of the rock, I saw you. My God, Elijah said, there you are. There you are. You come down in a chariot of fire. It took me out of here. There you are. And they followed Him. Recognized Him. All them religious devils, they cast stones, and they cast spears at Him. They wanted to murder Him because they thought they knew God, but they didn't. If they knew God, they would knew Jesus. Come on, somebody. But watch this. But those disciples is so caught up in their torture now, their pain, that when He walked by, the Bible said He would have passed them by. But He cried out, thank God. Sometimes you better learn to cry out. You might not can fully understand the glory of God. And you might not recognize him as Spirit and Truth. You might not recognize him as of this or that. But you know it's him. Glory to God. You better learn to cry out. You better learn to just give him everything, your whole heart. And if you will do these things, listen. It's in these times when we're rowing, it seems like we're going the wrong way. When we're toiling, when we're in our pain, when everything, it takes every ounce of energy to get out of bed in the morning, when it seems like everything around you that you cared for died, when it seems like everything around you is against you, it's in those times right there that our character can be developed, friend. I said, if it's always good and there's never a problem, if there's never persecution, if there's not trials of our faith, before long we won't have faith. But it's in those times of even not understanding. If it's left up to us, we would never, ever want to do or go through what we went through, or you know people that's went through things. But in those times is when our character can be developed, friend. I said it's in those times that our faith can be tested. It's going to take them fiery trials. It's going to take them restless nights to try our faith. It can be tested. It's got, listen, friend, it's in those times that our patience then can be proven. It would have been a lot easier to throw the oar down, quit rowing, caught the attitude, he don't care. Where's he at? Because you've got to understand, when they're toiling and they're rowing, that devil's a screaming at him. Where's he at? Why ain't he here? He sent you over here to see you destroyed by the elements of something that he says he walks on top of. Where's he at? But they just kept on rowing. That's what you got to do, friend. You just got to keep on. You can't quit. You can't throw it down. You can't walk away from it. I know at times you might feel discouraged. At times you might feel lonely. At times you might feel like every ounce of fiber in your body hurts. It seems like your whole body's laying down. And you, even in your own mindset, said it'd be easier to die, go to heaven right now, than to keep fighting against all this. But can I tell you, if you've made heaven your home, it's secured for you. You ain't got to try to rush it. It's coming. Come on, somebody. There's a blessed assurance and a promise that I'm his and he's mine. He's got a place prepared for you and I. But what the fiery trial and the test of our faith is happening when he sends you over, when there's not one ripple on the sea, but before you get too far out, a horrific storm. They rowed for hours and hours, and they still not, because John records how far they rowed. And when you do the map and you do the study, it's about halfway across. Yeah. They've been out there for a long time and they still ain't but about halfway across. Look at somebody and say, we might just be about halfway across, right? Oh, yeah. I'm a firm believer that the American church is going to be persecuted. We're just halfway across. You say, when's this thing going to end? God don't let you fight it the whole way out and the whole way through. Because he knew, Brother Ronnie, he knew them boys couldn't, they didn't have enough energy in their physical bodies to get them across with a headwind blowing that hard. Now what should have happened? And I ain't throwing a stone, so you don't either. But could it have been possible? They've been following, and the answer better be yes, because they just got through watching Jesus take two fish and five loaves of bread. He fed 5,000 men plus their wives and all them children. Not just a child, some children. Lots of them. They just saw him do that. We can't pause and say, well, you know, one scripture, the next verse might be 3 years. It could be at times it was, but not here. Because Mark run this thing and recorded it, and they got through. Jesus said, they get in the ship, go across the Sea of Galilee. I'm going to send them away, and I'll come to you. Yeah. And the whole thing was because their heart was hard. Because they read it. They did not recognize the miracle of the fishes and the loaves. Yep. In fact, there was one time Jesus had to get with them and unbraid their unbelief. It's that their minds were so twisted up. So when I believe, and I think I can prove it, that in the midst of that ruin, in the midst of that toil, they could have got together and said, hey, we've seen this done before. Let us proclaim to that wind.
Yeah.
Because the wave wasn't the problem. It was the wind that was resisting them. Let's get together right now. Amen. And let's rebuke this headwind. My God, if we really want to get some faith, let's tell the headwind to get thee behind me and blow me across to the other side. Come on, somebody. But they got so governed by that headwind, it traumatized them.
Yes,
come on, guys. They rowing. Everything's hurting. Their shoulders is burning. And they just kept on. They got so caught up and they got so enveloped in that storm and that pain that they forgot the first rule that Jesus ever told them. And you and I do the same thing sometimes.
That's right.
Oh, you won't admit it.
Yeah.
But there's times you get blindsided or something happens, and before long you're trying to fight that headwind alone. When he's standing right there, we don't recognize him because that we see more of the headwind than the head. The good shepherd. Our pastor. The Lord Jesus Christ, our shepherd.
Yeah.
Remember,
yes.
They just saw him take just a little bit and turn it and feed a multitude. And just for the record, go back out there now and get the fragments. And 12 baskets of fragments. That's what God does. Think about it. It will take the same faith to stand steady in the storm as it did to distribute the bread. They put it in Jesus' hands. You can't listen. I don't know where you stand on this, but I don't know if them 12 disciples now, because this is the first time they're gonna see a multiplication of such so little to become so great. They fed 4,000 also. This 5,000, the feeding of 5,000now. There's a 5 loaves and a couple of fish. Jesus brought them into himself. Nothing happens until the Lord touches it.
Yeah.
Or until you touch the Lord.
Yeah.
But he blessed it. Oh, Father. He broke it. But he turned and he gave it to those disciples to pass it out.
Yeah.
Everything has come through his hands now. But if it's going to get distributed, it's going to be by the body of Christ.
Yeah.
And they saw such a great miracle. But my God, the word says this, that they did not. They considered. The word considered means to put together. It means to comprehend. They didn't comprehend the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. The word hardened in the Greek then means to petrify. It means to have a callous. As men, I'm sure we've all had women too, have calluses rubbed on. And the more you do a certain thing and use the same hand or do the same grip or something, it wears and wears. And then you get a callus on a callus and a callus on the other 3 calluses. Before long, there's such a build up there of just hard, hard skin that you can't hardly pick a splinter won't even go in right there. And if not careful, that's the same way our hearts get. They'll get so callous to the move of God. Them disciples that saw everywhere they went, they saw the dead raised. The blind eyes open. A multitude of people fed with just a handful. And all the time they finally realized, you know what? Okay, I'm used to this. It don't move me no more. And they took it for granted, friend. But can I tell you, our walk with God can be the same way. We can take the miracle of God for granted. Lord, help us if this happens. Man, I cherish services like this morning. We've been fighting hell, that demon. Division and unbelief and religious devils and all them things that are fighting against the body of the believers and body of Christ. The Lord blows his breath of revival through here. Man, wasn't that a wonderful word Brother Luis brought Wednesday night? Man, I want to tell you, that man's pure. He loves it here. He said, oh, amigo. And don't you get the big head, but he said, y'all got something special there. He said, I think it's that Red River. I told him next time he comes, he went fishing with Brother David again. Well, maybe we'll get a few men and go tight lining on the Red River and let him catch one of a big old blue cat or something. Amen.
Like that.
But listen to me now. You here that's in your storm this morning. You here that's fighting it seem like all hell and there's a headwind blowing against you and you can't make no ground. You can't get ahead. You can't get no further. You might have been to this place. My God, they're rowing and all of a sudden just the gust. It goes from 70 to 80 or whatever. The gust and it pushes them back a little bit. Fight harder, guys.
Yeah.
Fight harder. Come on, push through it. And they make it, they make them three or four rows back up to where they gain a little bit of ground. About time another gust comes. But then all of a sudden something come across the top of that water that could control the elements of not only what was on the outside of the boat, but what was on the inside of the boat. And they looked at him and they were so caught up in it that it frightened them. Because they thought it was a spirit. But I love what he said. Be a good cheer.
Yes.
For it's I.
Yes.
For it's I.
Yes.
Now that gives grounds for some unbelief to say, well, who's I? Is I you or is I someone else? Come on. But they knew his voice.
Yes.
Come on, they knew his voice. Faith comes by hearing. In Jesus, he spoke to you and it sounded like thunder. But the more you walk with Jesus, the quieter his voice got. So it becomes still and it becomes small. But the way that you got to hear a still, small voice is you better be still and small yourself. Not so elevated or puffed up in your mind and always trying to cause racket. Those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They talk about some mountain up, wings as eagles.
Yeah.
They're gonna run. Come on. They're gonna fight.
Yeah.
Come on, they're gonna have victory.
Yeah.
I'm just adding to the scripture. Man, that scripture's wide open.
Yeah.
Man, yes, sir, I'm gonna have victory. Amen. Glory to God. Listen, I'm almost through, but listen. Some of you here this morning might be in a peril. Your voyage has been hindered. There was some unexpected interruptions in your walk with Jesus. You got news you didn't want to hear. You've had confrontations you've tried to avoid. You've prayed feeling like you're the loneliest person in the world. And fear is trying to get a grip. But faith rose up, especially in the book of Matthew, when Peter said, okay, Lord, that's you bid me to come out there on the water.
Yeah.
And he stepped out of the boat. There's been no ceasing of the wind. Now he steps out of the boat. So now there's an oar there with nobody to man it. But I don't read where they lost no ground. And when Peter took his eyes off the Lord, because the wind was boisterous, violent, he began to sink. Glory to God. But I still don't believe the boat was going backwards. I think everything stood still for the presentation of a man just as ordinary as you and I to do a feat that only God could.
Amen.
It's God ordained. It's God led. It's God called. It's God ordained, or it's not going to happen. And he walked. Peter walked on water. But when he saw the wind boisterous, you can't look at Jesus and look at the wind. He sank. Peter reached down, picked him up. Then he's going to deal with him now. Where's your faith? They walked back to that boat. The Lord ain't fixing to chase that boat going backwards. No, he ain't. He's been to that bank already. He said, let's go to that bank. Come on, somebody. So he's got everything thrown. I want to tell you, my God, I want to tell you, I believe water got so solid he could have nailed that boat down right there at the top of that lake. And we got through the business of Peter wishing and praying that all of his disciples would have followed suit, because Peter wouldn't have been the only one. I think James and John, my God, they all could have walked on water. You see, some of you ain't believing this because you see the challenge is too great. The sky's the limit. The promise is endless. If you would just get some faith and believe God. He ain't dragging Peter by the hair of the head back to the boat and throwing him up in the boat. They're walking together. They get in now and they go to the other side. Why? Because every hindrance now is stopped.
Yes.
The wind ceased.
Yeah.
When the wind ceases, the waves stop. Come on, somebody. And now all of a sudden, every stroke, Brother Greg, they're making headway now. Oh, what a deep message. No. This gospel's for children to understand it. Glory to God. Every stroke, he's on board. Dear God, how many knows he's on board this morning?
Yeah.
Stand to your feet this morning. Give the Lord a good clap and say, Lord, I know you're on board. I know you're on board. Glory to God. Lord, hallelujah. But Jesus, he allowed all this, and listen to me. In closing, the Lord allowed this storm to come. I'm not going to say the Lord sent the storm. I'm not going to say the devil sent the storm, or maybe it was just time and world, the world's existence for something in the atmosphere to cause the storm. It could have just been an earthly event. Man, every time the wind blows hard, people thinking it's the end of the world. It's been like that forever. The currents, they say you can plug a bottle, put a cork in a bottle, sling it out over the East Coast, and that thing will travel all the way around the world and come back because of the currents. I believe that God gave man ability to walk on something that he just flung up there and it hung on nothing called the moon. There's people with conspiracy theories thought that whole lunar project, Apollo, this and all that, was done in somebody's big warehouse in the back 40. I believe God gives men intelligence to overcome, to conquer. But if they don't respect God, all them smart, educated minds could find themselves out there in the oxen field eating grass with the oxen. Technology is just, be careful lest technology lead you astray. The wind's got to come sometimes in our life just to prove if we're going to keep rowing or not.
That's right.
We live in a soft generation now.
Yeah.
Nothing, I ain't talking about it. I'm just saying, come on, guys. Some don't go their way. Well, you know what? They just pick up their ball and go play on somebody else's court. Come on. We one church service away from a full-blown church split. When we think as a man thinks, or a woman thinks.
Yeah.
Now, you said we got problems. No, I didn't say that. But every organization, every church out there runs the same risk. When people begin to think as a man and not the ways of the Lord, then there's problems, right? And the only way we're going to overcome is through Him, the Lord. Just look at somebody one more time and please encourage them. Keep rowing. Just keep rowing. Don't stop.
Don't
stop. I know you feel like you're pulling more than the next one is. I know you feel like you're the only one really trying, but don't just keep rowing.
Yes. Yes.
Because sometimes, guys, we do have to take somebody else to slack up. Because
yes.
Somebody might be tired or weary or their pain is so powerful in their life that they just can't do. Come on, some of us elderly folks, say amen here. We might still get it done, but it takes an extra 4 or 5 hours to do it. All these young people are like, oh. Yeah, I've seen that many times. Okay. Just keep rowing. They're going to get to the other side if they stay unified.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah. Jesus is going to sit there for a long time and watch them fight it. Mm-hmm. But something in his heart must have said, they're not going to stop. They are determined to fulfill the word of God. Come on, somebody. But he won't put on you more than you can bear, so now he's walking on the sea. Come on. He walked by. I think he slowed way down and got real close because he wanted them to acknowledge him.
Yes.
But he looked in their faces. See, he don't have to have a light to see the face and the heart of man.
That's right.
He is the light.
Yeah.
But he walked close enough that he could see their pain and their struggle. And all the time, all he wanted to hear was his name called.
Yeah.
It's I. Everything stopped. They got to the other side. And I love this. And immediately, the people on the other side recognized him. And they brought all their sick.
Yeah. Yeah.
They brought all their bound.
Yeah.
They brought all those that had infirmities. And listen, I just sit back and took this in as I was just studying. And whithersoever he entered, Jesus, into villages, or cities, or country, they laid their sick in the streets and besought him that they might touch, if it be but the border of his garment. And when I read this, I've known it for a long time, but it just seemed like it just rose off the page. And as many as touched him were made whole.
Yes.
I didn't read, and as many as he touched was made whole. As many as touched him. You know what I'm trying to say? I'm trying to say that you better keep rowing, friend. You better just keep rowing, huh? Because you got to give to him. He is your answer, glory to God. I know you're in the midst of a storm this morning, but you just keep on keeping on. You keep on praising him and worshiping him. Many that touched him. Those that couldn't get to him, he always made sure he went by them. But there was plenty that when he passed by, they heard it was Jesus. They screaming and hollering and said, oh, I got to touch him. My God. But if not, but the hem of his, I'm going to touch him. And listen, they simply said, I'm not going to quit till I touch him. Because if you'll touch him, it's virtue that leaves his body. It's virtue that brings healings and deliverance.
Yes.
So we want to pray right now.
Yes.
I want to do something I've not done in a long, long time. I want everybody to bow their heads. Close your eyes. And I want you to acknowledge by just simply lifting your hand while nobody's looking around this morning. And somebody say, you know what? I think I quit rowing. I'm tired, I'm weary, but I'm ready. I'm ready to pick the oar back up. Come on, if that's you, that you got so discouraged and you got, the pain has tortured you. The realness of the infirmity and the pain has tortured you that you just feel like you've got nothing else to give. You can put your hands back. Oh, can I tell you, the healer's in the house this morning. The healer's in the house. He alone will calm the wind. And if you're too weak to calm the storm or speak to that storm, he will become your strength again. Well, I ask this now. Will you find an altar? You that lifted your hands, you that wants to pray, find an altar and say, Lord, give me the strength.